That's pretty lame. Good evening, and welcome to the second lecture in the 2012 Clarence R. Noe Dean's Lecture Series. Tonight, Dr. Alice Zhao, Assistant Professor of Chemistry, will talk about her research on anti-cancer treatment. I want to mention, though, before I talk a little bit about Dr. Zhao, that this series is named after Dr. Clarence R. Noe, who was a Eureka College graduate class of 1938, and who also served as the dean of the college for many years. Now, Mrs. Noe, who many of you have seen and some of you haven't, his widow, has been a part of this series and a supporter of this series for many, many years. She's not here tonight, but I wanted to make sure that we recognize and remember all of the support that Mrs. Noe has given and remember Dr. Noe's investment in the academics at Eureka College. I do also want to mention one other person, and I haven't seen him tonight, but Dr. Jerry McCoy was the one who, when he was in my position as dean of the college, created this series. And since 1980, faculty members have shared their scholarly work with the Eureka College community and the broader community, and we've all benefited from the wide range of presentations we've heard over the years. So again, let's think about Dr. McCoy and thank him for the vision that he had in creating this outstanding series and for providing the Eureka College community with opportunities to remember and honor the contributions of Dean Noe. Dr. Alice Zhao joined the Eureka College faculty in 2009 as a faculty member in chemistry. Since coming to Eureka College, Dr. Zhao and her colleague, Dr. Kevin Stillman, have reinvigorated the chemistry program and have brought a tremendous number of students into the chemistry major, and they've also strengthened the sciences generally across the board and have joined a very, very strong group of faculty and made science and math even better. Dr. Zhao holds a medical degree from Capital University in Beijing and a PhD from Florida Atlantic University. Her talk tonight is part of a larger research project on anti-cancer and antivirus drugs, and this is the point at which I say, please remember to turn off your cell phones now. Forgot to say that before I heard that cell phone. Dr. Zhao has challenged her students in her three years at the college, and they have risen to the challenge with her support and her mentoring. She's a terrific colleague and a tremendous asset for the college. Please join me in welcoming our speaker tonight, Dr. Alice Zhao.
Okay, so today I will talk about one of my projects in anti-cancer agent development. So basically, my presentation will have three parts. And the first part actually will be the introduction of cancer. And then the second one, the part two actually is we are going to introduce what is drug discovery, what is drug design, and what is drug development. And in part three, that's when we really go to the chemistry part. So what kind of chemistry reaction we have to do to synthesize some compound, and what kind of structure we want to synthesize. And after we synthesize it, what kind of test we want to do to figure out the biological activities. So part one, the introduction of cancer. So cancer, everybody know cancer, actually it's already become one of the most feared disease. Cancer is the second leading cause of death, actually, in the US. And in 2012, American Cancer Society actually just published a report. And this one says about 580,000 people actually will get cancer this year, will die of cancer this year, and which means more than 1,500 people die a day, which is a large number. And one in three people will get cancer, and one in five will die of it. If you think about how many people you know, or how many people in your family, that's a very scary number. 1 in 3 will get cancer. And it's not only that, it's also the expense people have to spend on the cancer treatment. It's very expensive as well. Normally, a common family probably couldn't really afford a long-term cancer care. And still, from this report, it mentioned in 2007, in year 2007, there were $226.8 billion was spent for cancer care. So what you can see is it's really a very expensive disease. And also from this article, it's mentioned the new cases are expected to have in 2012. And what you can see is here, for the male, the number one cancer actually is prostate, female is breast cancer, and both of them actually is 29%. And following those actually are lung cancer. That's 14%. For both male and female. Most basically, lung cancer actually is worse than others because you have 14% of people get it, and the treatment of lung cancer, we don't have a very effective way. So which make lung cancer, the death rate of lung cancer pretty high. So when you look at the estimated death, you can see the lung cancer actually become number one. In male, it's 29%. In female, it's 26%. So what is cancer? How cancer cell is different from the normal cell? Normally, the normal cell has a special shape. And then it divides with a regular rate. And after a while, if there's a damage on the DNA, actually, our body have a special system, special mechanism, just kick it out and just let kill those bad cells. Those are called apoptosis. So apoptosis, normally the cells, when cells is doing division, the maximum number it can do is 50. After 50 division, the cell normally is considered down. And then also apoptosis can happen. But not the cancer cells. Cancer cells normally, they lost their special shape and characters, and then they just grow and grow and grow, divide and divide and divide. You can see it's just, there's no mechanism really stop the cell division. So that's not the worst. The fast growing is not the worst. Also, actually, it can travel through the bloodstream and get spread to other body part, and then get secondary cancer or secondary tumor to other body parts. That's the worst. So many times we talk about cancer, we say there's a last stage of the cancer. What do those stage means? So here, actually, this slide shows what is the basic stages for cancer. So when we have benign tumor, the benign tumor is just when you have a cell, it starts to divide faster than regular cell, but it's still very localized. And inside to cancer, which means this cell actually start to divide or grow uncontrollably. And then the next stage actually is invasive cancer. So now the tumor get bigger, and then the cells start to invade a surrounding tissue. The last stage, we say cancer's last stage of cancer, that's when it's called metastatic cancer, which means metastasis, which means metastatic happen. What is a metastatic? Metastasis, sorry. I just couldn't really pronounce that word. Metastasis. So what is metastasis? That's what I mentioned before. So the cancer cell actually travels through your bloodstream and get to other organs, actually, and then your secondary tumor or secondary cancer actually grow there. So that's the worst part of the cancer. Normally, when patients get to the last stage, the treatment can be very difficult. And then the death rate to last stage cancer is pretty high. So how about the cancer treatment? So basically, if we have a solid tumor, the best way is surgery. So we want to remove that tumor. And then if it's localized, some kind of cancer cell is sensitive to radiation. So radiation therapy is another way. When it's localized, we can kill the cancer cells. And chemotherapy, actually, what is chemotherapy? Chemotherapy, which means we use chemical. And then those chemical will kill the cancer cell. So basically, what you can see as chemist, so most people will be more interested in chemotherapy because that's normally the chemist synthesize the drugs and then those drugs start to get market and work. And there's other therapies, immunotherapy. There's some other new experimental approaches now is in progress. And then recently there's alternative medicine actually become very popular too. But like what I said, as organic chemist, we are interested in chemotherapy. We want to design some drugs and synthesize it and get it to market. So the chemotherapy agent, mainly, well, as anti-cancer agents, we can divide them to three big groups. One, we say it's drugs interfering with DNA replication. And then the second one, we say it's drugs interfering with transcription and translation. And then the third one is drugs interfering with mitosis. And in the first category, drugs interfering with DNA replication, it includes anti-metabolites, DNA intercalators, alkylating agents, and some antibacterial agents. What we are going to interest in actually are DNA intercalators. So what are DNA intercalators? So DNA intercalators, they do a special job by insert into DNA structure. So what you can see here, those purple thing, those means actually are intercalators. So they insert into DNA and change the DNA structure and then stop DNA replication and transcription. So now let's take a look how those drugs can be discovered and designed and developed. So normally there are three stages before a drug really get to market. So the first stage we say it's drug discovery. And then second one we say drug design. And the third one, drug development. Drug discovery, that's when chemist is trying to find a lead compound. What is a lead compound? Lead compound is a structure actually has some promising activity, but not good enough to be a drug. So we know it's bioactive, but probably not as good enough to really get to the market, become a drug. And then drug design actually is after we figure out this lead compound or lead structure, we try to optimize it. For example, make it more selective, make the biological activity better or lower side effects. So something like that, we optimize the structure to make the drug better. And then after that, it goes to the drug development stage. So which means we will do a lot of testing of the drug. And then if it passes those testing, we register it with FDA, and then we design manufacturing process, And finally, it can get to the market and start to make money. So now let's look at what we do in drug discovery. So basically, first we choose a disease. For example, what we did, we want to treat cancer, right? So we choose cancer. And then second step, you choose a drug target. What part of, what kind of target your drug want to work on? For example, what we choose is the cancer cell DNA. So that's our target. And then normally you need to also identify a bioassay, which actually is what in which way you want to test the biological activity of your compound. So for example, what we did was we use cancer cells. And then use those cancer cells, we test our drugs, our compounds on it, see if those compounds can really kill the cancer cell. And the last is find a lead compound. So after you find a lead compound, it's not over yet. A lot of chemists will still work on it, work on this lead compound, and try to synthesize more and more and more. Those compounds they synthesize will have a similar structure of the lead compound. Why they do that? They are trying to figure out the structure relationship, structure activity relationship. So for example, if there is a methyl group, what will happen to that structure? If there is a acetal group on it, what will happen to that structure? What will be the activity? So there's a lot of compounds they have to synthesize to really figure out this structure-activity relationship. And after they figure it out, they can find the key structure really responsible for the biological activity. And then that one actually is called pharmacophore. So that's the key structure they want to identify. And after they identify the key structure, they can try to optimize it. So when they are trying to optimize it, there are two parts mainly they focus on. One is pharmacodynamics. The other one is called pharmacokinetics. What is pharmacodynamics? Pharmacodynamics is what a drug does to the body. And then pharmacokinetics actually study what the body does to the drug. So both of them need to be studied and optimized. And then it moved to the last stage, which is called drug development. First thing people want to do actually is patent the drug. So when they do patent, normally they get 20 years. So which means other people normally they cannot make profit based on what they figured out. And then after that, they also do preclinical trials, which include in vitro tests and in vivo tests. In vitro tests actually is tests on cells, enzymes, and tissues, so no living things. But in vivo tests, that's when the tests are on living animals. And after preclinical trial, they normally start to design a manufacturing process. The reason is actually they need to make some drug. If they if the drug passed the preclinical trial, they want to make those pills or injections, make those drugs, so it can go to the clinical trial and reach actually test on human. In clinical trial, there's phase one, phase two, phase three, test on human. And if the drug passed those three phases, phase one, phase two, and phase three, clinical trials, it can actually get to market. So ideally, a drug actually, before it really reached to market, there's so many testing has been done, right? Ideally, it's supposed to be a very good procedure, but in this world, actually nothing is perfect. So there's a lot of difficulties and problems. One of the problems with this whole process is it's a very long process. So just between a chemist synthesize a drug, an active compound in the lab until it gets to market, it takes average 15 years. So 15 years, think about 15 years take for all those process until this drug gets to market. So a chemist probably in his life, if he's lucky, he probably can only see one drug get to market. So it's just very long process. And also, it's very expensive. So here's an example of how expensive it can be. For 10,000 structure synthesized, only 500 will reach animal testing. And then only 10 will reach phase one clinical trial. And then only one will reach to the market. So that's 10,000 structure chemists synthesized. I'm sure in my whole life I wouldn't be able to synthesize 10,000 structure actually. So it takes probably a lot of people and a long time to finish all those. So think about how much money the pharmaceutical company has to invest just to develop, just to do one drug discovery and development. And the development cost of a new drug was estimated as $800 million. So every time we talk about how expensive is our medication, so here's actually how those drugs can be so expensive. So it's just because pharmaceutical companies have to put so much money in research, and all those money we have to pay actually. So probably people will say that's synthesized drug, right? So 10,000 synthesized structure. How about we just go natural products? That should be cheaper, right? It's not really. Natural product can be very expensive as well. Here's an example, that's Taxol. Taxol is a very good chemotherapy agent actually used for lung cancer, ovarian cancer, and breast cancer. And Taxol actually is in the bark of a kind of tree called Pacific yew tree. And 120 gram of that bark only can make 1 gram of Taxol. So if you count on that rate, we probably kill all the tree, and then we couldn't cure many lung cancer patients. So basically, you can see we don't have that much wild Pacific yew tree. So basically, if there's a problem like that, pharmaceutical company want to synthesize it. So if we synthesize it, then it should be cheaper. The patient should be able to afford it. But when you look at this structure, a big structure like this, you can see how complex it can be to synthesize a compound like this. So there's one person really succeed. This is called Holton total synthesis. So this is not all, this is just first slide. This guy did synthesis. Second slide, all those reactions this guy did. Third slide, still keep going. Finally, get to the product. So if a drug has to go through that many steps to synthesize, you can imagine that price cannot be low. So it must be very expensive. It's probably more expensive than the natural product then. So Actually, this guy did all these not for profit, just for fun. He did that all these for fun. He thinks it's, you know, pretty cool to synthesize a very complex structure like that. So that's why what I say is natural product can be very expensive as well. So there's other problems. One of the problems is selectivity. We want the drug to be very selective. Why? So we want the drug only have the biological activity. We don't want the drug work on other body parts and then cause the side effects. So for example, if you have a drug targeting on a bacterial enzyme, and then this enzyme is not in human body, so when we try to use this drug to kill the bacteria, we wouldn't really affect human body, right? So that's a good selectivity. Unfortunately, not the cancer, not the anti-cancer drugs. Normally, when we are killing the chemotherapy agent, when we are killing cancer cell, we also kill normal cells, make the side effects of those chemotherapy agents pretty high. So what if we test all those drugs and then we FDA approved it and it get to market, and then there's some unexpected side effects. Normally that's where the tragedy starts. So typical example, very famous example is thalidomide. Thalidomide actually was developed by a German pharmaceutical company, and it was prescribed to pregnant women to treat morning sickness. Unfortunately, the thalidomide actually is a sterol, it's a mixture of stereoisomer, two stereoisomer. So one can treat morning sickness, the other one actually cause the baby born with a birth defect. So those babies, when they born, you can see their arms actually are very short. So from year 1956 to 1962, about 10,000 children actually was born with birth defect. It's because of thalidomide. So you probably will say that is long time ago, right? 1956 to 1962. Even if it happened right now. So if you remember, what is that called? Y-Ox. Y-Ox was on TV commercial, I think, on in year 2000, 2001, 2002, you know, all over the TV. It was a drug developed by Merck, but in 2004, they have to recall all those drugs because it can cause the heart attack or stroke of the patient. So there were total 60,000 deaths was related to that drug. But Merck actually made $2.5 billion just from Viagra. So it's not only a long time ago, even right now it's still happening. So another problem we are facing actually is clinical trials in children. There is a lot of people just don't believe that's the right thing to do, which I understand because I wouldn't send my son to do any clinical trial. It just doesn't make sense. So still, there are two voices about it. One says, you know, people are even against testing drugs on animals, and now we want to test drugs on babies. How can that be possible? And then there's other people are saying the problem is the drugs we are giving to children right now, more than 50% of them have never been tested on children. But children have different metabolism system, completely different system than adults. You cannot consider children as a little version of the adult and then give them medicine. It won't work. For example, aspirin. Aspirin is very common drug we take as adult. But when you give it to children, it may lead to Reye syndrome, which is a potential fatal disease. It can lead to brain damage and liver damage. So, which is actually a very good tip here, never give a sick kid aspirin because that's not allowed. So it's just the children, they have completely different system actually. If we don't know anything about it, we don't know anything about those drugs, how can we prescribe them? So those are the pediatricians. They get really confused many times when they are practicing. Because, you know, doctors supposed to know those drugs before they prescribe it. But actually, a lot of drugs have never been tested on children. So those pediatricians, they don't know. And talk about finding a lead compound. It's very easy to say, yes. Find a lead compound, right? But actually, it's very hard to do. Think about natural products. How many are there? Are out there? If you test 100 a day, so you still wouldn't finish in 10 years, probably. And think about all the structures you can put together. How many you can synthesize. It's just very hard, actually, to really find a lead. So a lot of time, actually, you need a little good luck to find a lead compound. And typical example, Viagra. So Viagra actually was first developed as a vasodilator. It's supposed to treat angina and hypertension. But when it got to clinical trial phase one, they figure it doesn't work on heart, but work on other body part better. So then, you know, what do? They spend a lot of money actually on it. So the Pfizer is a pharmaceutical company. So I think they're very smart. So they think about, you know, just use that side effect, they think, you know, and then work on that and actually to make it a drug. That's how Viagra actually got to market. And they really did a good choice because in 2 years, they made $1 billion just from Viagra. But in the meantime, actually, that's what they can see, because Viagra originally was a vasodilator. The side effects of that actually is heart attack, stroke, low blood pressure, extremely low blood pressure. So all those can happen. So now let's look at how we are going to develop some anti-cancer agents. So we actually synthesize some intercalators, and we also test them in vitro. So here's the outline. First, we will talk about what are DNA intercalators. So I couldn't find a very clear picture to show, but this is so far the best I can find. It's, I copied it from an article from 1961. So intercalator, so normally it's a planar structure. It can insert between the base pairs on DNA. So the structure of the DNA will change. So this is a common intercalator. But there's another one, it's called Bees intercalator, which means you have two those planar structure, and then there's a linker, link those two two planar structure. Those are called either linker or spacer. So it does a similar job, but both of the ring actually can insert into the DNA. and then change the shape of the DNA. So what we are really interested in, actually, are the Bees intercalators. So here is the structure of DNA, actually. What you can see is between those base pairs, actually, you have a space here. So these are the space the intercalators can insert in, and then so far change the structure of it. So these are the known compounds have anti-cancer activity. Those are all Bees intercalators. So we check all those structures. There are more, actually. I just put three as examples. So we check all of them. So what we figured is it must have two aromatic rings. And those two aromatic rings on the side and then linked by a linker, probably different length. Those linkers are different. So what we think is, what if we make a Bees intercalator similar to those? So what we want to do is we want to have two pyrimidine rings. Those are smaller rings. And then, but nobody ever tried it. So we think, why don't we try it? So that's why we choose those pyrimidine rings. So to connect these two pyrimidine rings, we have a linker, which is R. We tried different type, different shape of the linkers, and then to see if the activity will change. So there are total three different types of linker we tried. First type is polymethylene chain linker. Second type is polyether chain linker. And then the third one actually are linkers with benzene ring on it. So we have to figure out an organic reaction to synthesize it. So this reaction actually pretty simple. It's a nucleophilic substitution reaction. When we have an amine group here, the nitrogen, because it has a lone pair on it, so it's considered to be a nucleophile. So it will substitute the chlorine on the pyrimidine ring. So after first ring, attached to it, and then the second ring will attach to the other side of the linker. So now let's look at the polymethylene chain linker we synthesized. We synthesized all those compounds with different lengths of those linkers. So polymethylene actually are CH2. So we can have different number of those CH2 in between. We have 3, we have 4, 6, 8, 10, 12. So we tried all six of them and then tried to do some in vitro test on cancer cells. We tried 5 different cancer cells. And then after we test on them, we see when we have 10 polymethylene linker or 12 polymethylene linker, it shows the best anti-cancer activity. When those numbers are higher than 50, that's when we say it has anti-cancer activity. So how about if we try polyether chain linker? So polyether means we actually have oxygen between those CH2. So those are called ether groups. So we have different lengths as well. So you can see all those have different lengths on the linker, and then we test on the activity. Unfortunately, it's not active. Actually, before we prepare it, we were thinking it probably won't be active. The reason is when we are having the oxygen on, the oxygen normally have a lone pair on it. So those are potential hydrogen bond acceptor. So might have other interaction with DNA. So might affect the activity. So it shows no activity. So how about the last group? Last group we try to synthesize. was linkers with benzene ring. So benzene ring are like this. So those are planar. So when we put the planar benzene ring in the linker, we affect the shape of this whole molecule. And make this, those linker will make it more rigid. So we tried these five of them, and then we test them in vitro test. And it's very interesting because it looks like this compound 3 actually shows the best activity, which actually explains because it shows the right angle actually properly. So is this one, when the linker is this one between the two pyrimidine rings, that's the best. So based on those compounds we synthesized and those tests, we actually can get to our conclusion. So we totally synthesized three series of compounds, three series of these intercalators. We can say it's pretty successful because there were a total 8 of them show anti-cancer activity. That's actually very rare because a lot of people synthesize more than 100 structure, probably none of them show activity. So we were pretty lucky actually on this one. And the best actually is when we have polymethylene linker, when we have 10 carbon and then 12 carbon on the linker, that so far shows the best activity. Based on our test, we also can say the bioactivity probably are related to the length of the linker, the flexibility of the structure. What we can do to push this project further? So far, whatever we have done is just trying to find a lead compound. We haven't really got to drug design yet. We are just trying to find a lead compound, which is the first stage of drug discovery and development. So it's drug discovery part. So based on that, we already learned something. So if we want to do further research, we probably want to synthesize more of those structures, analogs of the structures, and then try to test on activity, figure out what really affect activity. So that's structure activity relationship we try to figure out. And then after that, we can try to optimize it. That's the drug design process. And if we really can optimize it, the structure can become a future drug candidate. So it might take a very long time actually to do all those. Okay, so that's all for today.
So do we have any questions that you'd like to ask here, or Dr. Zhao, or obviously you can do that at the reception afterwards?
It's because of the DNA structure. If you see the space between those base pairs, they don't have much space there. So if you have planar, it can fit in. Any other questions? Yeah, right? Yeah. There's no treatment actually because of birth defect. There's a lot of foundations. After this happened, there was a lot of foundations they built, especially focused on helping children with this type of birth defect. Actually, no, they didn't do surgery on those kids. It's very interesting because they can use their, it's very short, but they can use their arms. I had a friend back in Florida. He was from Iceland. He had arm like this short, but he was one of the most athletic person I ever seen. He played all kind of sports and really was really expert in almost everything. So I would say it's probably inconvenient in their life, but there's no surgery need to be done. Expect if they have some other kind, serious kind of problem. Because the mother took a lot of thalidomide, their legs and feet can be affected as well. It's like a flipper shape kind of feet. So that in that case, I can see something must be done. But I don't exactly know. This is just one of the projects we did. We also synthesized some anti-metabolites. You probably wonder why we choose these two. Here's what happened, okay? So there's a joke about it. There's a person is searching something on a very dark street at night, and there's only one street light there. And the person passed by, asked, "What are you searching for?" And this person say, "Oh, I lost my key on the street." And then he just keeps searching. And then the other person asked, "Why are you just searching under the light?" And then the other person say, "Because that's the only place I can see." So basically, a lot of time, when we are doing the drug development, we choose the project a lot of time is because that's the part I can see, we can see. We also sometimes you probably ask why we choose this compound to synthesize, why we choose that compound to synthesize. A lot of time it's just because we have the material in the lab, so we just use it. So it's not because of a scientific reason we choose it. The total, all the synthesis of the drug was done in my PhD time. So there were my advisor and there's the other graduate students in the lab, you know, things like that. So it's not by just myself to synthesize all those, especially those biological activity tests. Because we are chemists, so normally we send it out to other labs to do those. there are chemists are doing something like that, or scientists that are doing something like that. So all their job in the lab actually was testing compounds synthesized by other chemists. And then they figured it's not active or it's not working on their target, but might work on something else. So all their job was testing something like that. Actually, yeah, there are some drugs, you know, really get there. If we say it's accidental, it can be, but still, it actually takes a lot of scientists work on it very hard to figure it out. No matter its structure or synthesis of it or doing preclinical trials and for it to get to clinical trials, it takes a lot of people, a lot of money, actually. It's kind of accidental, but I would say, you know, luck really play a role in there, but it wouldn't really fall from the sky. I didn't test those on cells. Those in vitro tests was handled by another lab. We just sent our sample out. So normally, people work on different fields, have different specialties. As organic chemists, we only focus on organic synthesis. We don't know anything about biology. So we just sent those compound out to a biology lab to test them. So you can see we test on five different cells. Why we test on those? Because those are free. So those lab, the biology lab we send the sample to, they already have those cells in their lab, so those are free tests. So that's the reason. I'm sorry? Here are, what are those cells? Not all of them were in human. Like this one was not in human, obviously. It's marine leukemia cell.
All right, well, there's a reception afterwards, and I invite you to come up and ask more questions of Dr. Zhao, and thank her once again for a great presentation.